What's up, Greg?
Just so you guys know, normally we start the show dancing to the theme song that my son wrote, but I was catching up on the show, and the theme song for this show was so fucking dope. Do you guys remember it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Of course.
Okay. Hold on a second.
Great.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm gonna play it because it's really good. Okay. Can you guys
yeah,
see my
you
screen?
Should. There it is.
Okay.
Are we gonna dance to the Ghostbusters song?
Oh yeah.
Well, this here we go.
Yes.
If there's something strange in your neighborhood, who you can call? If there's something weird and it don't look good, who you gonna call?
That's right.
Yeah!
It's so good!
What though?
Right?
I love it.
Quite alright.
Badass. There I am.
Tiny.
Yeah. Shut up! It's nice. So good!
Come on.
What a good looking show, too.
Were you in that?
It's amazing.
You know what? I watched
show.
The pilot episode and I watched a few others, and I'm like, this show was fucking dope.
Yeah.
It was really good. And also, like, to me, it holds up. It's got this real, like nostalgic vibe to it that's like, ah, you just get sucked right back into childhood. Like, it's really good, is what I'm trying to say.
It needs to come back.
I was so jaded. Thinking, I like, oh, this is show, it's show friends. I keep forgetting to know it's show business. And when I asked Audu Payden, our producer, I was like, so why'd you guys decide to do another Ghostbuster series? He's like, sell toys.
Yeah.
What? And I was like, oh, that's right. That's all it was. And because the toys didn't sell, despite the amazing work everyone did, both, you know, in front of the mic and behind the mic and the art department, all the animators, it suffered.
You know
it
what?
Is because they joined
never...
the dark side.
I've never heard that story, and that's fucking tragic. Because it was a
really
good
sad.
Show with a lot of heart. Yeah. It was like the first Ghostbusters who have to have a girl, to have a guy in a wheelchair. That's it was right. Diverse and awesome and ahead of its time, and we're going to get into all that. But I just want to introduce the room first so that everybody knows who everybody is. To my left is Miranda Parkin. She's amazing. She's going to do some fun stuff that you guys don't know about quite yet. And I'm just going to go in order of my screen. So Jason, please tell everybody who you played on Extreme Ghostbusters and where they can find you on social media.
I played Garrett. Hey, what's he saying? New York Heights is in the house. Who are you going to call? Call me on Instagram or the TikTok or the things. Just type in my name.
Awesome. Greg Cipes. Don't say anything. Maurice LaMarche.
I am Emperor Palpatine.
Okay, Palpatine.
No.
But who are you on Ghostbusters?
Hi, guys.
I'm
back. I'm back, and I didn't play William Shatner on the show. However, I did play Dr. Egon Spengler. And I did Spores, Molds, and Fungus, and I helped form the new team of Ghostbusters.
Yeah, you did. Yeah, you did.
Yeah, you freaking did.
Where can everybody?
I was sitting in that firehouse all by myself.
Yeah.
Really lonely, except for Janine.
Where can everybody find you?
Get things going
on social media. Where can they find you?
Where can they find me?
Yeah.
Just look under, like, open up your computer and look like where all the bugs are crawling. That's where I'm at. I'm at Maurice LaMarche, MauriceLamarche. All one word on Twitter, at Maurice_LaMarche on the Instagram, and that's it.
Billy, who the heck were you on Extreme Ghostbusters?
Yeah.
Well, that's a long story. It's a very
he
long
played
story.
All the
and
characters.
I don't want to, well, you know what? It's the I played Slimer in a show, and they were like, what do you think? You want to do Slimer? And I was like, yeah, I guess, but that's, you know, Frank Welker. Well, he doesn't want to do it. He won't do it. And I was lied to. And so that's how I wound up doing it. And
Wait, they lied to you about Frank not wanting to?
Yes, they
show
did.
Business? Oh, somebody lied?
Yeah, somebody what? Lied. They either turned Frank's request down for money, and it was suddenly I felt like I became my own enemy. I became what I hated the most as some grave robber, you know? So I'm just being honest, but I did love the show. I loved Audu's artwork. I loved everybody's voice work. I loved those nighttime sessions.
Yeah, watching so Mo, fun.
Watching Mo fall asleep in the corner and then
I had a newborn son.
That's right. Yes. And you were a very busy right. boy.
When we were doing this show, my kid was, you know, between 3 months and a year and 3 months. And he was not sleeping through the night. And so, yeah, I was passing out because we had to do this show at night. For those of you, listening, because Jason was on a sitcom and
Alfonso.
I know Alfonso, but there was a lady, I can't remember her name. She's a wonderful actor, and she was on the Drew Carey show with the big blue high shadow.
Mimi,
she was on the show, and she, like half the cast couldn't get there till after six because they weren't wrapped on set. So you were on day by day, right, Jason? I'm still in God's spell mode because I'm in a Jesus robe. So I'm day by day.
That's the only cartoon I've ever done at night to this day.
Yeah.
You know what I liked about it is I used to, you know, I loved everybody. I honest to God, I'm taking this opportunity to tell all of you that I love you and you mean a lot to me. You know, and I've been telling everybody that means anything to me that because you don't know what's going to happen. You know, it's just like, I'm losing friends here and there. And you pick up a newspaper, even Belzer, Mo.
I know Belzer's gone.
Belzer.
But yeah, Coolier is still with us.
Coolier's here.
Cooler.
Yay.
What a comedy of errors trying to sign on with you guys. I won't get into it, but hi.
Well, we're happy Tablet. You're here.
I love you, Spartacus.
We didn't get to say hello to Reno and Pat yet.
Okay, let's say hello to everybody, and then we'll get back into the stories, because the stories are good, and they're wonderful. Mm-hmm. And thank you for saying that, Billy. I think we all really loved each other and still do, too. Pat, will you please tell everybody who you played on Extreme Ghostbusters and where they can find you on social media?
I played Janine Melnitz, who was massively in love with Egon, who could have given a rat's ass about her at all. And she was constantly trying to get his attention and still man the phones. Ghostbusters, you grab them, we slab them. I mean, you know, it was so fun. And you're right, evening was the most fun. It was like a cocktail hour with all of us without the booze, you know. and really, really fun. And Susan directing us, if I recall Sue correctly. Yep. It was a Sue Blue show, right? Mm-hmm. And... it was just really fun. Scream music. Isn't that where we were?
Yeah.
So, and you can find me on Twitter at Music Talks, MusickTalks, or on Instagram at the same.
Thanks, Pat. Reno.
Hello.
You're next. You're up.
Hi. I'm Reno Romano, and I played Eduardo Rivera.
Yes.
I was going to say I played Kylie.
I was the only girl in the show. You did kind of play her.
Did. I wanted to. She wouldn't let me.
I know.
That's who I am. I'm Reno. And although I don't really participate in social media because I'm like a dinosaur, I am on Instagram and I'm Rino Romano VO. That's RINORomano VO for voiceover. There you go.
Reno Romanovo.
Yeah, Reno Romanovo. That's me.
It was a Slavic name at that point.
It is.
Okay, one more. Dave, for those who don't know, tell us who you played on Extreme Ghostbusters and where everyone can find you on social.
I was Peter Venkman all those years ago. And I'm on Instagram and Twitter. Once I found out that Facebook had my entire life in an archived zip file, I left Facebook. But I'm on Instagram and Twitter. And I don't like social media.
I get it, but you know what? You look good, kid. You look real good.
You look real good. Yeah.
Thanks. It's this sweater. you know, up, it's uplifting. It does all kinds of things. It's a $3,000 medical sweater.
There you go.
It looks good, kid. Do you remember auditioning, or did they just offer you Extreme Ghostbusters? Do you remember that time?
Well, he was the OG Venkman.
In
the real Ghostbusters.
In the real one. In the first one, right?
Yeah, yeah. Dave was on was on Real Ghostbusters.
Yeah, yeah. So do you remember the audition process and how, because you, well, I feel like you, Mo, and Pat were all kind of doing like impressions but making it your own, which was amazing. And then Jay, me, and Reno kind of had these original characters. Billy also was basing it off something, and you guys were all so brilliant. Like, do you remember that moment when you were auditioning and how much OG you wanted to put in?
You know, I just basically did a Bill Murray impression, and that was it. It was just kind of very simple. But I was filling some very iconic Lorenzo Musick shoes, and it was something that really kind of played with my head at the time, because I thought his voice is so iconic and so recognizable. And here I'm just coming in doing a schlocky Bill Murray impression, you know. So, but it worked, and they liked what they heard.
You made it your own, man. And there was nothing to do for, you know, Lorenzo, God love him and God rest his soul. You know, he was doing his own, you know, thing with it, and you made it your own as well, you know. And they just decided to switch horses halfway through production, and you did a fantastic job, man.
Yeah, you were great.
You're both great.
Because
I worked with both of you.
Funny, really charming. And I don't know, I hadn't done animation with you before. I don't know how much you did, but you were just like any of the legendary voice people. You just jumped in and you were wonderful on the show.
Well, it was, you know, I just remember laughing with Mo and Frank and Arsenio. I mean, it was like four of the most immature people you could possibly sit in a recording studio. It was just, anything would set us off. Like, and it was just so sophomoric. It was like burping and farting and just stupid stuff. And we just couldn't compose ourselves.
They taught me how to hand fart. I didn't know the technique.
I did.
He had master classes in hand farting during Ghostbusters.
Hey, that's a good skill to have.
Do you guys want to show it? Do you want to show
Mo
hand farting skills right now?
Fart, Mo, fart.
You got a little
fart.
Mo.
Well, sure. I mean, sure, absolutely. what I like to do is celebrity wind impressions. So if you name somebody, I can do their wind.
That's just so name exciting.
Don Hamm.
It's not called that anymore. It's called Fartificial and Smelligence.
There you go.
Jason said that was good.
Jason said John Hamm.
Only Billy would know.
Yes, it's a-hole eye.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
See, that's really good. And right. I haven't shaved. Usually I need to be clean shaven to really,
that's right,
you know, show the masterful ones that I do. So we're saying John Hamm?
John Hamm from Mad Men.
All right, here we go.
Did you guys hear anything?
I didn't hear anything.
Was it an SBD, Silent but Deadly?
You didn't hear anything?
I might have clipped the mic. It's probably really loud.
Oh, those new iPhones have anti-fart recording.
Oh.
I'd say that was a Silent but Deadly. That was brilliant.
It's a Zoom thing, because you don't want to fart like in a meeting.
So it looked so good.
Filter, you're right. Let's try
technique.
Another one.
You could see both hands were going into it. It was great.
Someone, thank you for noticing. Thank you so much, because it is a skill.
took 2 years of it in college.
Someone petite. So, let's try someone petite. Maybe.
Do me.
Okay, here we go. Are you standing or sitting?
I'm sitting. Do you want me to lean over? I'll lean over.
Long pants, shorts.
I've got yoga pants on.
Okay, here we go. All right. Here's Tara, yoga pants.
Come be a voice actor, kids. This is what it's like. This is what it's like.
It's so, so fun.
So Dave taught me the technique, and I can only do one, but it's here it is. It's Peter Falk.
Okay.
Excuse me, ma'am. I'm sorry.
This was my first big U.S. show, and I had just gotten to the States, and I walked in, and I looked down the aisle and said, holy shit, it's Billy West, and there's Maurice LaMarche. I think Christy McNichol was there, too, and other like guest stars, and Linda Blair. But the point is, within 2 seconds of hearing everyone do exactly what you just witnessed over the last 5 minutes, I laughed my ass off, and I said, holy shit, this is going to be fun.
Yeah, that was a good time. Yeah. That was a good time. Do you guys have favorite memories of recording sessions? Anyone? Anyone can take it.
One of my favorites is when we were all doing, and I wish Alfonso was here, we're all doing our warm-up for the engineer, and like just for fun, you know, we usually grab like a line or two to test out the mic, and to be funny, Alfonso started singing Amazing Grace, and it was so wonderful that we all just kind of like stared at him, and then he almost inviting him to sing the whole, and he sang the whole song for us. Does anyone remember that?
Yes. And by the way, I've heard him since. He's an incredible singer.
Yes, he is.
Really incredible.
That was a fun moment.
And dancer, by the way.
Yeah, amazing. Hello. He won like Dancing with Stars. I did invite him. I haven't heard back from him. Maybe I have old contact info, but he's lovely and we miss him. And he was great on the show too. Super great.
He was, yeah.
Okay, anyone else? Favorite moment?
I know.
Okay.
You were a young ingenue from Toronto.
What do you mean were?
You were or was. I don't know how many years ago. Is this 30 years ago?
No. Sharon Duff.
Yeah, I was not.
She's still young.
28 years ago. 28. Yeah.
And she sat next to me during those sessions. And I was going through a really rough marriage. So I would find myself drooling, staring at her while she was doing her lines. And then she'd pull out like her lipstick and start doing her lips because she knew that I was looking at her. And I was going out of my mind. I said, this, how can I work this? You know, she must have a boyfriend. Yeah, I know. You may find yourself sitting next to Tara. You may find yourself watching it.
No, if you had just done the fart noise, Billy, I would have been all.
No, yours. I did. I did all that stuff. Nothing worked on you. You didn't like me.
That's not true.
I think you liked me because I was a vegan.
Yeah, but
that's right. You had gone vegan. Yes.
That's not why.
I remember that. I remember you're going vegan and saying to me, ice cream, bad. Don't eat ice cream. Remember that?
I used to preach, yeah.
Yeah, so I was
just a little scungeely, you know.
I
just thought that Tara was great, and I did, and Tara remembers this. I just stopped one night and I just looked at her and I said, you know, you're going to be such a big deal, honest to God. Aww. You know, because you have a light around you, and aww, you know thanks, that. Man. You know how I felt.
Aw, that's so sweet. Thanks, Billy.
Yeah, honestly.
I mean, I was in town from Toronto, like Reno, not that long, and those rooms were so impressive. You guys are all superstars. It was pretty impressive. It was fun. That was a fun show. It was fun. Pat, Mo, got any fun or favorite memory stories, or Dave?
I remember there was one time where I...
Yeah, you fell asleep a lot. Fell asleep a lot. It was one of our favorite things to clock, actually.
Yes. Yeah.
I really don't because of how fucking exhausted I was. Doing those nighttime sessions with having an infant son at home, I don't have a whole bunch of memories. But in general, it's that thing Maya Angelou says that you don't always remember what people say, but you remember how they made you feel. And right. I always had a good feeling about this show and everybody on it. And we were just we were this late night family, but we just had a great time. And you and Reens were like, you were like my kids, because I'm Toronto, but I'd been here a little while, but I like felt I had to look out for you. You're like my little niece and nephew,
even though we're not related.
But it was like the Canadians got to take care of my Canadians. And, you know, and I loved Jason from things we've done before and things we've gone on to do since. We've got a text chain from Transformers Rescue Bots that's still going 10 years after the show started, you know, five years after.
Mm-hmm.
It's so, it just I don't have great stories about it, but just wonderful feeling.
Do you remember the audition? Because yours was also, again, like based on.
Well, my audition for real.
Yeah.
My audition for real Ghostbusters was, like immediately after the movie came out, they knew they had something. So it was like a couple of months after the film came out. And they told me, and they told everybody, they came out to a waiting room full of actors, and I was the new kid on the block, but we had like really established people out there. And Arsenio and Ernie Hudson were the two African-Americans they were the only guys reading for Winston. And Arsenio, I remember, looked across at Wally Burr's packed waiting room, went, he just mouthed, "What the F am I doing here?" And I just was like, because we knew each other from the store, from Comedy Store. And Michael C. Gross came out and said, "Okay, I know you've all seen the film. Don't do impressions. Whatever we could get the real people if we wanted. They're executive producers on the show. But we want you to do an original thing. These are the real Ghostbusters. We're going to do an episode where we find out that that Bill and Harold and Danny based the characters on you guys. So you're the real Ghostbusters." And they did do an episode like that. So I went in there and I looked at the model sheet, and it just looked so much like Harold. They didn't give him the blonde hair yet. And I just went, "I haven't gotten any other ideas except Harold Ramis." And it came out. Spores, molds, and fungus. And I was like, I finished it and I just went, "Well, I screwed the pooch on that one." And I stepped out and Michael was waiting for me on the other side of the door. Remember that long door at VoiceCasters, at Wally Burke. And I at that long hallway, and he just went, "You get to do an impression." And that was like, okay, thanks. And I got home and there was already the offer. So, I mean, I was lucky to be booked right there and then.
Great story.
Yeah.
I love that story.
Yeah. So I got to be Egon for, I think I've been in every episode of Real and Extreme and Slimer End.
Awesome. You must get a lot of fan stuff at cons then.
I guess Egon is probably right up there with Pinky and the Brain and Futurama for sales of autographs. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. I love that story.
I remember one night coming in and Eddie Albert was the guest.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
He was there.
And his son had brought him and driven him. And I was just floored because I love old movies. I love old TV shows. I was crazy. And Eddie Albert, and he looked fantastic. He looked so good. And so I was sitting there talking to him. And as I was talking to him, I realized that he was not tracking. He was not tracking. And I was like very worried because I loved the fact that we all got to record together. What a blessing. And I knew that he wouldn't be able to do it. Just from talking to him, and his son was smiling and laughing and everything. And I went into Susan and I said, "Excuse me, honey, you have to do him separately. You got to do him separately. Otherwise it's just not going to happen from that." So I came back out and Susan came out, of course, and acted as if, and then she goes, "Eddie, come on, let's get you in and out. You don't need to sit here and be here all this time." And she took him in and recorded him. And I remember his son coming up to me and giving me a huge hug and a kiss and saying, "Thank you so much for that," because I don't think he ever would have made it through the whole session, you know. Yeah. But he was fantastic because he went line by line and she worked with him line by line. And so it was fine. But the best part for us was all being together, because that's a magical thing that doesn't really happen very much.
For sure.
Anymore,
for sure.
Right.
I don't remember that story at all, but. Oh,
I just remembered something very funny about my audition. I went in and I auditioned and I saw Joe Medjuck and I thought, "Where do I know that guy from? He looks so familiar." So I went and then I got the call from Brad Gray, who was my manager at the time. And he said, "Dave, you got this Ghostbusters thing, okay?" And I went, "Okay, great." I went home, and later that afternoon, I see Joe Medjuck across the street, directly across the street from me. And I went, "Joe?" And he goes, "Dave, I had just moved into the house. We didn't know that we lived across the street from each other.
And I lived around the corner on Whitsitt Avenue. I remember that house.
He used to come and Joe lived. He lived across the street. And I said, I can't believe we've never met. I said, I see you like taking your garbage out and I see you once in a while, you know, but I never put two and two together. So we were neighbors and I would see him and we would meet in the, you know, out in the front lawn and he would just say, you guys are absolutely out of your effing minds. And it was just because we goofed around so much in the, you know, in the sessions. And he would just shake his head and just kind of go, you guys are nuts. But yeah, it was a weird thing. I just remembered that.
Wow. That's wild. That's insane. Reno, you got a story?
I do. I'll tell you the real quick version of it. I was so excited about this. First of all, what Billy said, in the 30 years I've been doing this and lucky enough to do this, I love this show. This was my favorite show because it was so much fun. It was episodic but serialized, so the characters went through, and it was all characters. It was a story about all of us interacting. So the ghosts and everything were there, but anyway, I had a great time. So I wasn't casting it originally. I didn't get it. I was so right for it in my head. I was like, I should get this. I didn't get it. I was so bummed. I was like, oh, well, I guess it wasn't meant to be. Then I get a call back like 2 weeks later. I'm like, how did I get a call back? They already cast it. They may not be happy, so they're going to have you come back in. Wow, okay. Sue was so nice to me. It's between me and someone else. She says, but just do what you do. I said, okay. So I did it, and I didn't get it. I was like, man, I was sure. I really want this. Wow, shit. I guess it's not for me. Whatever. Another week or two go by, and they say, listen, they're going to have you back in. I said, really? Are you kidding me? Yeah, here's the thing. They're going to have you record with the cast. So it's an audition. They're going to pay you, but it's a paid audition. It was so nerve-wracking to have this, but I was like, okay, well, give me a shot. I'm going to do my best. So the whole point of this setup was I walk in, I sit, and I look down the aisle. Like I said, holy shit, there's this, and there's everybody, and there's Tara, who I know. I was like, all right. And then I look at Marsden, who's sitting right next to me, and I go, hey. And he looks at me, and I've never seen this in real life before. He goes, hey. And he does literally a spit take or a triple take. He goes,
yeah.
And I look at him, I go, what's up, dude? Like, what's up? He goes, oh, nothing. And I go, wait, what? And he goes, you look just like the other two dudes. And I was like, oh. all right. So he thought I was the other guy. He talked to me for a couple seconds first. Anyway, that was that. And then the only other thing I want to say is I was so excited and so nervous. And I knew Tara from Toronto a little bit. We weren't close, but we'd known each other and you'd come here before me. So the whole point of the story is I'm so nervous. I'm doing a good job. And Sue goes, keep doing what you're doing. I'm like, so the thing finishes. I go home and I say to myself, you know what? Whatever happens now, I don't care. I'm happy with what I did. And I swear to God, the next morning I look at my face and I go, the hell's on my face? I didn't have a beard. There was a black mark on my face. And I go, what the hell is that? And I try to wash it. It won't come off. And like 3 hours later, it's still there. I'm like, what is this, a sign from God? I don't understand. I've got like a black red welt here. I'm like, I don't understand what's happening. Later on that day, I just go like this. I go, oh, shit. I had been so nervous during the reading that I'd sat there like this.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God.
The whole time, yeah. Just.
Yep.
You made that a mark.
I'd given myself
a
black welt and didn't even know it.
You made a mark. You made a mark.
You know, I remember
there was
two other kids, like kids that were, that they cast to play Reno, to play
Eduardo
at the time. And I remember they were fine. It felt a little out of place because one was actually a minor. I think he was 16. And then you came in and as soon as you spoke, I just remember feeling like, oh, this fits. This fits really good. I hope he stays. And thank goodness you did. You did.
Wow. Me and Tara.
By the way, we didn't see you sweat. I had no idea.
Not at all.
No.
Not at all.
No idea.
I was shitting my pants, but tried to keep it cool. I was like, just do your job.
It was good.
You belong here. You belong here.
Yeah, you do. You did.
It was my first big job in America. So I was like, come on.
I know.
You're the sweetest guy.
Yes.
Sweetest guy.
Hey, man.
I have a memory that I can't figure out if it's a real memory or if I made it up. So here's my chance to find out if it's true. Because we were recording in evenings together, we would have dinner a lot and we would talk and hang out and talk about life and blah, blah, blah. And it was really awesome. Mo, did you used to put peanut butter on pizza?
No.
Okay. I made it up.
It sounds like me, but I can't imagine doing something so disgusting.
I was like, what?
You got to put a note that's like, This is not, the statement is not true. Terror of Attraction.
I feel like I'm like I was a prequel to The Whale.
No, no, no. Prequel.
No.
No.
Right. The Porpoise.
I'm just glad we got that straightened around.
No, that might be a dream you had.
Maybe you'll make that dream come true.
Or perhaps it is one of your fantasies.
Tara
Strong is getting on.
I just remember meeting Tara and having her take me out and meet her parents in the car.
Oh, yes.
I remember Tara's parents coming to
session. You would do this with everyone. You would take each person out and go, you have to meet my mom and dad. And it was so sweet.
Pat, I remember your daughter would come to the session. She was so young. She was what, like
was
4, 5, 6? Yeah.
She was in her pajamas. And Jeff would bring her before he'd put her to bed. He'd bring her over to the session so she could say goodnight.
Mm-hmm. She was in her pajamas, but she was already a superstar.
She's about, her new show is about to drop, so it should be pretty cool because it's a musical.
And no way. What is it?
She sings and dances. It's called Up Here, and it's the story of Kristen Anderson Lopez and Robert Lopez, the EGOT winners who did Frozen and all these shows, and it's how they met and how they got together. She was gone all summer shooting in New York, so, and singing and dancing outside in New York. So
fantastic.
It was pretty crazy.
So great. Good for her.
She's never not worked, right? She's always.
Pretty much. Like, never. Yeah. Never not.
She's amazing. She's a little firecracker, that one.
Yeah. We're doing Johnny Bravo with her.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Yeah. She was 5 years old when she did Johnny Bravo. 4 or 5 years. Yeah.
There's a piece of video tape on with time code and everything on the internet of Mark Hamill and Seth MacFarlane was there, and I think you're in it too. I think we did the pilot together. I was the announcer, and little beautiful May and Jeff Bennett, of course, and it's just all of us riffing and having fun.
Brenda Vaccaro playing Johnny's mother.
Yep.
I played her like this. She was hilarious.
I want to go back to Jay because I never knew that was the reason it got canceled. Like, that's so sad. And, you know, they didn't really put out a lot of toys. So what were they expecting? Like, usually when you're on a show that you know comes with a built-in fan base, you do some dope-ass merch. There's some kind of crappy toys, but there weren't, like, amazing things, right?
And they were progressive with the show, having such diversity and having, you know, Garrett in a wheelchair. But they wouldn't make Garrett in a wheelchair as an action figure, what I was told. They thought it would be insensitive to the children who are in wheelchairs.
Did they never do it, Jay?
They went as far as to make, and I saw pictures of this, a prototype of Garrett with bionic legs. That's, talk about insensitive, that's insensitive. But the toys didn't, and as a fan of the OG real Ghostbusters and who collected the toys, they didn't really hold a candle to the original toys.
No, they were crappy. That's really fucked up. I'm really sad about that because, once again, I don't remember a superhero before in a wheelchair, like, busting ghosts. Like, you were, like, an amazing, iconic character way before time. It should have had every damn toy. And I don't think there's been one since, right?
Don't think so.
Sad. What a tragedy. You are amazing. And I'm sure you get like a lot of love for that and fan mail for that. People at cons.
Yes. Well, there's the 501st, the cosplayers who dress as like stormtroopers. They also have like in every city, there is a team of Ghostbusters.
Absolutely.
And they love it. They love the show. I've been gifted. I'm sure you guys are the same. They've gifted me like EPK readers that they make and jackets and patches. Yeah,
it's
not, you guys are like Jedi.
I got to get on that con circuit. I need an EPK.
Yeah,
come
we've
on,
never
man.
Seen you at cons. They,
these guys are like Jedis building their own lightsabers.
They each make their backpack. Ecto-1, wasn't that what it was called? I think.
I've seen the car a few
each
times.
Each chapter has its own Ecto, and they all make these intricate backpacks that are heavy.
They're insane.
The sounds, and it looks just like the backpacks in the movie, and that's part of like your entree into becoming a Ghostbuster.
People go around doing
charity work.
Oh yeah, they're
charity
they're
work.
Amazing.
I don't know why I'm waving my hand like Trump, but to go around doing charity work, children's hospitals and openings and things like that, raising
really
money. They're amazing people.
They're really amazing. It's a wonderful fandom. We had some of them on.
Have a one.
What?
Oh, so are the 501st. They're I mean, they're the same. They're of the same cloth.
Yeah, or... no, the Ghostbusters crew, they're really sweet. We had some cosplayers on yesterday for the show, and they make all their own stuff with 3D printers, and all the buttons work, and they had, like, she would want, the girl that cosplays Kylie made her boyfriend the hat that Rick wears, like with the, like this upside down strainer with all the buttons and shit that goes on. And right. She went on
like
eBay.
All accurate.
Yeah, she went on eBay and got like circuitry from that time. Like it had to be exactly like the show. And they're so cute. They have these like big meetups, as you know, and they were talking about like their advice to people that are afraid to cosplay, and they're like, you know, put on a suit and you're one of us. And it's like, oh, they're so cute. Yeah. I love that.
Reno, would you do the con circuit? Would you leave your
in
house?
A second, I've just been hiding. I just don't really do them, but because I don't think anybody cares about me. I don't think anybody cares. Yeah, of course I would.
You were a Batman. Crying out loud.
I was Batman. I'm proud of it too. Yeah, yes. I would do it. Of course, I just haven't done many.
You know what we should do? We should put together a Ghostbusters con.
Oh, that'd be great.
That make up a panel, like at least a panel at like LA Comic Con or something.
There was, yeah, I got invited to one in Glasgow. I didn't end up going, but I mean, it's a serious deal.
Yeah. I just went there this summer, by the way, just socially, and it was amazing. Scotland's beautiful.
Yes.
Nice. There's always such a big presence of Ghostbusters cosplay at all the cons.
Always.
Really?
Yeah, always. And they're amazing.
The tough part
is
getting Frank, because Frank is under contract to Hasbro for Transformers. So he doesn't really step out of his Transformers appearances. And Arsenio, I have tried, and he's always got a stand-up going on any given weekend. He's playing clubs and theaters. So
we can make it happen, though.
We can make our extreme happen. That would be beautiful.
That'd be fun.
Yes.
Pat, do you go? I haven't seen you, I don't think, at cons.
I did one here in Pasadena. This last, when the hell was that? Was it in October, maybe? There was one in Pasadena that I did. And
Pat, I still love your voice.
Yeah, I'm sure folks would love to have you. You were wonderful. I wanted to ask you, too, about your audition, because yours, again, is also somewhat of an impression, but with your own spin on it. It was so cute.
Because Annie Potts was in the movie was so specific. Mm-hmm. And then in the... in Real Ghostbusters, who did her in Real Ghostbusters?
First it was Laura Summer. She was the first movie. Right. And then ABC sent down a note that she was that the Janine design was too slutty. It's actually written on, I saw the model. They wanted the dress lowered, and they wanted her to sound more Midwest and wholesome. So Laura, unfortunately, lost her gig, and then they brought in Kath Soucie, which is the first time I ever worked with Kath, and she was that wonderful Midwest wholesome sound that Kath has. Mm-hmm. And then we went back more to model for Pat's version of Janine, you know. And of course, the idea being that we were now in our, you know, Egon and Janine were now in their 40s. They were old now in their 40s.
Yes.
You know,
ancient.
They were kind of just friends and kind of a little more. We never quite figured out.
They were a ship on the show for sure.
Yeah, they were.
I like the ship.
Yeah,
and I also, like you guys the Egon.
Yeah, you guys were also.
Is that the name?
Flirting with each other a lot.
Janine Egon.
There was more flirting from Janine to Egon than there was. I mean, Egon and the spores. I had to get through the spores.
Yes, and the molds and the fungus.
A lot of crazy stuff. Actually, we all had a lot of crazy stuff to say, except Billy. Billy didn't really have any like science jargon to say. Sorry.
I figured they some nights drank the green stuff and went at it behind.
Billy, I remember them like really impressing upon you, like, we want Slammer to not say any words at all, not articulate any words, but you had to emote and say phrases. I think they wrote down the phrases in English, but you couldn't like say any of the words. And I was constantly impressed that anybody could do that. I've never seen anyone do that. And I don't know if you ever had a hard time doing that, or if it was just effortless on your part, because
I was an objective fulfillment machine. It was like, whatever you say you want, I'm like a journeyman, you know. I'll bring like nails and hammers, and you know, you tell me you're going to build a proscenium, okay, I know how to do it. You know, it's just I was looked at it in that regard. But I told you earlier that I was I was miffed, and I was between the devil and the deep blue sea, trying to perform as Slimer because they lied to me about Frank not wanting to do it. And you know, like I said, I was mortified. I was a new guy.
When did you find that out, though? How far into it were you when you found that out?
I found it out I think we were almost midway through. Mm-hmm. And I said, you know, it's just so strange. Why wouldn't he want to do that? It was the most perfect, beautifully crafted, macabre, humorous character. And, you know, and I just thought, I just felt like a little drip going in there trying to replicate that. But, you know, they said, no, we want you to do it. And Frank's not going to do it. So, you know, I just did everything I could to make up for the stuff that I wasn't able to do. You know,
I mean,
like
you did a great job, Bill.
I don't know what you're saying. You were brilliant.
Yeah, you were amazing. Brilliant. And by the way, we've all been there. Like,
you've been lied to.
Yes, and the fact that it still bothers you, and my experience still bothers me, just shows that we're really fucking good humans. So, like, let yourself off the hook because you're torturing yourself, and you were wonderful. And
can I hear a little bit of it?
Yeah, for Greg hasn't heard it. Can you remember? Can you do it still?
What?
Slimer.
Can I?
You. Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know. I don't remember what I did.
I'm remembering all of his Jennifer Tilly impressions.
Oh, right.
I remember him saying, and then I hit my head, and then
Jennifer
I hit my
Jennifer Tilly
head.
In my soup.
We had so much fun. I just remember laughing my ass off. Yes. Yeah. That was my baptism by fire. Tara, I was like, these guys are crazy.
Tilly. Yeah. Yeah. It was so fun.
Tara and I used to go for coffee afterwards. Remember when I asked you, hey, what are you doing? You going home? You said, I don't want to go home to this boyfriend of mine. you had this guy that was like, you know.
Remember that guy, the British guy.
Get rid of that guy. And when are you going to get rid of that dumb wife of yours? I said, I'm working on it. We used to sit in the front seat of my car and have coffee, and it was all innocent, and it was really sweet and nice. And I was thrilled to be working with you.
No, yeah, we had such a good time. We really did. Yeah. I mean, and by the way, I would do it again if they. When I was watching, I'm like, they could totally do this again. Wouldn't that be fun?
I would do it in a second.
It was so ahead of its time anyway. It would be so easy to reboot it for a new audience.
Right. And now, like, Kylie has other girl Ghostbusters. They had the movie with the girl ones. And I think it's a good time to revisit all these characters, too. It'd be so fun. Right. And
They did a comic book, and they integrated all the characters from the real Ghostbusters, Extreme, and even some of their offshoots.
That's what they should do. They should do multiverse Ghostbusters.
They did it with real and the film Ghostbusters. They actually had the real Ghostbusters meet the film Ghostbusters.
But I'm saying they should do an animated series multiverse.
They should.
All of us. That would be kind of dope. And hello, multiverse is
madness.
Everything saying. Ectoplasm all at once.
Yeah. Yeah. Greg, do you want to ask your stupid question?
Dip, marry, kill. There you go.
Okay, so this is Greg's great question, and it's ship, marry, kill. So we make everybody answer this question, and you can either do it as yourself, like who you would ship on the show, who you would marry on the show, who you would kill on the show, or who you would like to see your character ship with, marry.
Ship is relationship, so like who you would want to be in a relationship with.
I didn't know that the character. Last time I did the show. I had no idea. I thought it was some kind of FedEx reference.
No, it's
me here as a veteran. Now.
What are the three choices?
Ship marry, kill. As yourself or as your character with anyone on the show?
I think you should go first.
Okay,
and set the example.
Okay, so for instance, I as Kylie, I think I'd have to ship Eduardo. I think we had like a fun banter, right?
What is
relationship?
Make out, sex.
Oh, that's what ship means? S-H-I-P, ship?
Yeah.
Relationship.
Shipping,
baby.
Okay. And my answer is F yeah, of course.
Yeah, so that would be a ship. But I think I'd marry Jason. We'd make such cute babies, right?
Right.
And yesterday, actually, someone said they wanted to kill you, Eduardo. They wanted to kill you. Sorry, just letting you know, one of the cosplayers.
Fair enough.
Ship, marry, kill. oh my God, I wouldn't kill anyone on this cast. I guess I'd kill like one of the horrible. I'd kill the executives that canceled the show.
There you go.
Oh, yeah. Dang.
I second that one.
Okay, so that's how you play. So whoever wants to go next can go next.
I'll go next.
Okay.
I would relationship Kylie as Eduardo because I think we did like I think we did 40 episodes, and I'd say on the 41st we would have gotten together because there was so much tension.
There
was
a lot
come
of
on,
tension. Right?
It was so fun. I'd marry her as well, and I wouldn't kill anybody. I'd kill a ghost. I'd kill all the
double
ghosts.
Kill,
three kill, double kill.
I would ship my Janine.
Oh.
And then I would marry my Janine.
Aww.
And I would kill Slimer because it doesn't matter. He's already dead.
Right.
Oh, and we could bring him back. We could bring him back. Aw, the fans are going to love that.
I would definitely ship Egon. I've always wanted to do that. Aww. I would marry Egon. I would kill those fucking spores that he always paid more attention to than me.
Right.
Hey.
Right.
And on that hell note, guys, I have to run.
Miranda, do you want to show him anything before he
goes? Oh, yes, I do. I do. I did a little Janine and Egon.
That's perfectly timed.
He's got his 90s. He's got his 90s ponytail.
Can
I get a copy of that from you? It's so
of course.
He literally just
absolutely.
She drew that while we were talking.
Hey, Mo, before
how talented she is.
Before you go, Mo, I want to say that you and Billy, everybody was so nice, but you and Billy really were like mentors. You really looked out for us. We were all younger, man, and you guys were just so kind and so encouraging, and I just loved everything about that show. I really, really did. It sounds ass-kissy on a show about the show, but I had a great time, and you really were nice, and you gave me the biggest compliment in the world. You're like, you know, you remind me of me. I was like, what a nice thing to say.
No, I meant it like this. I said you look like me when I was your age. And you see that, and like I want to treat you better than I treated me.
Aww,
because the me nice at your age,
so
I became,
sweet.
I beat him up, and you were like a second chance for me to be nice to young me.
Aww. You're making me emotional because you really were good to me, that's and you're a good man. I'm glad to know all of you.
That's what I really. If I didn't, I mean, I meant that when I said that. I didn't like, hey, you remind me of me.
I meant it. I meant it like you meant it. In other words, you spoke from the heart. It meant a lot to me is what I meant.
Yeah.
You guys were all great.
Will you take a picture too?
Oh yeah, I'll take a picture. I'll take a picture before everyone goes.
Hold up your drawing too.
Oh goodness. Well.
We'll pretend this is a big old sweater.
Yeah, it looks like
it. Right?
Really, the Palpatine thing works. Oh,
it
just.
Yeah. It does. It does work.
Are we taking a picture now?
Yeah.
I got to pose.
All right. 3, 2, 1. Cute.
Bye, Mo. We love you.
I'm so self-conscious.
Love you, Mo. Love you.
All right, Jason.
Greg, I want to see your drawing.
Jason has
to like that.
Kill. What is that? It looks like a
it's Slimer and
carbon copy of what Miranda did.
That's what I did.
I love it.
Greg, how dare you? That's plagiarism.
Wow, so good.
I'll send it to you guys.
Please.
Please.
I'll put it on the Twitter.
Autograph.
Do you still wear holsters, Greg?
No, I don't. I'm an artist. I'm an artist now.
No longer voice actor.
Yay, Jay, shit, Mary Kill.
It's so tricky. If I'm thinking as Garrett, the automatic response would be Kylie, but I feel Kylie.
Marry me, buddy. Marry me.
Garrett and Kylie had more of a bro sister relationship, and he definitely had like a bro relationship with Eduardo. I think it would be like one just big pile. I think I'll bet Garrett was pansexual. He loved everybody. He's gonna ship and marry everybody, and he'll just keep killing them ghosts because that's what he's all about.
All right, I like
I like it.
Billy, do you want to take it?
Can I ship Sue Blue?
If you really want to.
No, wait. I just
we
remember
do not
that one.
Kink shame here, Billy. We do
I
not.
Just, I just remember that wouldn't work.
Okay.
I don't know. Kill somebody?
Or
who do you want me to fucking kill? You want me to kill somebody? kill fucking Christopher? Or kill Dr. Melfi? Dr. Melfi, she deserves to die. Mr. Soprano, you're suffering from secondary anxiety with delusions of persecution. Oh, good. I thought I had fucking dandruff or something. It's terrible.
I remember hearing Mo and Billy doing Fred and Barney. I mean, perfectly.
Yeah, yes.
As Jehovah's Witnesses.
Oh my God. Uh-huh.
Like knocking on the door, like, take the watchtower, Fred. Fuck off, Bon. Anyway.
How do you remember all that stuff?
Because it was so good. It was like the personages were so good. And then like the comedy of like, what? And they talking about each other's wives. It was good stuff.
All he had to do was just say one thing, or I could say one thing, and we were off on a comet, you know. And plus, you were the best audience, really. You know, you would sit there and just go, "What the fuck is this?"
Yeah, so you guys got away with murder. You got away with
yeah.
Murder.
I feel like.
Hey, Fred, you ever think of Jesus?
Yeah. Oh, come on, but Mo, bang on.
I just remember when my daughter came and found out that Billy was Doug.
Oh, right.
Oh,
she about died.
Did she cry?
She loved that show.
She loved that show so much. I was
Doug a great show.
Pat, you asked me, who did Doug, and I said I did. She yeah. said that you thought it was like some kind of kid or some freak man boy or something.
I mean,
exactly.
Such a great character and so real and heartfelt. God, that was a wonderful show. I love that show.
Well, they're 30 years older now. So it's like, dear journal, today I blew up a courthouse.
For the Doug fans, that's pure gold.
You don't know how they're going to grow up. You know, you always think the good kid's going to be one thing and the bad kid's going to be. No.
Billy, you did a Ren and Stimpy for my answering machine, and Mo did a Toucan Sam, and I remember I loved it, and I got such props for it.
Really?
What would Ren sound like at 65?
I don't know. I mean, come to a session, and I'll show you, because we're doing it again.
Are you doing it again?
Yeah, we've been recording it again.
Nice.
I know. Amazing. It's like, I said, you better keep a paramedic in the lobby. You know, I was a young guy when I did that. I had a lot of energy.
It's fantastic, man. Aww.
Yeah, I just don't want to stroke out. Maybe I do want to stroke out, though. What a fitting end, you know? No, in front of a microphone.
Oh, please don't.
You're not going anywhere, buddy.
No.
Let's not do that.
Yes, you.
Can you imagine living with Billy West? You guys, I don't want to keep you forever, but I feel like I could. Like, this has been so fun.
I miss this. It's been so long since you. I don't know.
Thank you so much.
Thank you guys so much. This was.
You guys are all in different states and stuff, right?
Yeah.
I'm in California.
I think we're all in Cali, except for Jay.
Jason.
Except for
Jason, where are you? Nashville?
Yes.
He's in a secret location, undisclosed.
But let's all maybe talk to our agents about putting together a con appearance. Because also,
why don't we start with a dinner or something?
Let's do it too.
That's a good idea.
Just bring a laptop or a plasma. Just put me in the chair.
No, you're flying in, buddy. Come on, you're coming.
Yeah, we could do dinner the next time you come to town.
No,
you do come, right?
Jason,
is there anybody?
No,
Jason. Tara has a private jet.
Oh. Well.
There you go.
I have a gig in Anaheim in September. That's right.
September. It is
closest. And it's funny. Mo was talking about the you should have the Rescue Bots cast on your show as well. It's another just like tight knit group of Steve Bloom and LeVar Burton. Parvesh and we love each other so hard. And so we'll probably get together with them.
I'd love to do that. If you want to talk to them at some point and put that together, I'd love that.
I will. I'll mention that.
I love being able to celebrate everybody because, I've said it a million times. I've said it online, too. Like, you can work your whole life voicing a character that changes people's lives, that touches people's hearts around the world. And, like, Hollywood could care less. But the fans that show up at cons and tell us how much we mean to them and, like, it's such a beautiful, beautiful way to give back, to go to these cons and to hear that we mean something, we matter to them.
Gosh, yeah, for real.
And so I'd love to highlight every show that means something to you. And
Here at the Cipes Show, we don't do it for toys. We do it for the fans.
That's right.
Yes.
Hell yeah. We do it for the
dig
love.
Dig it, dig it.
Can I tell you something? At the risk of sounding overly saccharine, as a fan, you guys are awesome. And Tara, I didn't say it enough. You're amazing. So fun to work with. It's been, I love watching your career, man. Look at you. You came from like, you were already doing good. Now you did all right for yourself.
Yeah, yeah. Look who's talking.
Yeah, exactly. Look who's talking, man. Yeah. Going from that to Batman to being like the voice of every network. Never have to leave the house. I'm so proud of you. I'm so proud of you, buddy.
I'm super proud of you.
You want to brag a little before we go, Reno? Like, you went from Ghostbusters and you don't do as much animation, I'm sure, as you love, but we ain't crying for you because you've got some pretty big gigs. Like,
I ended up doing a lot of promo work. I did a lot of promo. In other words, I got not out of animation. I just don't do as much of it. I got lucky and I did a whole bunch of TV network promos. So I was the voice of NBC for, I still sort of am, for 10 or 12 years, CW for over 20, Lifetime for 3 or 4. So yeah, I tell you what's coming on next on TV.
He's doing all right.
We get paid to talk. So, you know. But I'm just saying, I love you guys, man. It's been too long.
We love you too.
Mm-hmm. Same. It's Pat. Love seeing your face.
Guys, thank you so much, all of you, for giving this time. And it's been so wonderful. And yes, let's do dinner and bust some ghosts together. I love you guys.
And talk to your agents. Let's get a panel. That'd be amazing. Let's do it.
That'd yes, be panel. So I would be there. Hey. I would be doodling. I'd be drawing. I'd be doing all the.
Yeah. Hey, Miranda, all this dig stuff. It. Follow Pumpkin Art.
Oh, well.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, guys.
Bye.
I will email to everyone.
Bye-bye.
Love you.